Zach Sang Show. We are here with Alex Iono.
Whoa, you got it right. First time. I give you points for that.
Dude, right. Heather, Dan, and me, Zach Sang, all hanging.
What's up, Heather? What's up, Dan?
Hey, what's up?
Oh, what's up, Zach? Yeah, Zach, you gotta, you, yeah, gotta, what's up, too.
You seemed very into Dan when you came in, you
know? I just came, I you know, I the first person I saw, just thought I would shake his hand first.
Okay.
If I seen you first, the way that the door is set up, as soon as you open the door, it's Dan.
I totally get it.
You know?
And he tends to be the better looking one out of
between
the two of us.
That's not true. I like your hair. You're having a great hair day.
Well, thanks, man. Thank you. How is life right now for you?
Life is crazy. I'm so excited. I got a lot of things that are going on at once, and I feel very, very blessed, especially to be here today.
To say the least. I mean, you're right now on a radio promo tour. You're pushing. Would you say this is your first real single, like, that is completely yours?
Oh, absolutely. I would say it's my first fake single. I would say it's the first anything, you know? This is the first time that I'm really getting to be out there with the fans and getting my music out there. You know, I've released music before, and it was all kind of organic and independent. And so with that organic and independence, I didn't have the following that I'm blessed to have now. So it was a lot smaller. So this is the first big scale thing that I've done.
But you have a big following because of your YouTube, right?
Yeah, yes,
and
yes.
Your covers, which you call flipped versions of songs.
Flipped, reimagined, whatever you want to say.
Would you say a flipped version of Paris is the same as a cover of Paris?
I feel like, I mean, there's some people will just like learn the chords and they'll just play on the guitar and that's a cover. I think they're all kind of covers. I don't want to devalue anybody that's like singing their version. I think if anybody does their version of somebody else's song, I would always call it a cover.
So I get that.
A flipped version, I would say, is also a cover.
But also changed everything in it. You reproduce it, right?
Yeah, I reproduce it and I like to share myself with it because I feel like as an artist, being somebody who also writes their own music and produces their own music, if I were to just learn the chords, it would almost be a disservice to the fans because they wouldn't get to understand that I also do all of, you know, that's why I'll write a rap and put the rap in the song, or I'll write a new verse or change the lyrics to a cover if the lyrics that are from the original, you know, don't match what I do or what I believe as a human.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, I always like to put myself in it because it helps show and showcase that I'm actually an artist, that it's a real kind of tangible thing that like I can.
Of course. Like, and you get to learn, right? And
yes.
It showcases your talents. And once you create so many flipped versions of songs, you get really good behind the decks and
you just
computer.
Learn. Yeah, it's a great way to practice, really.
But okay. So how long does it take you to make like your average cover video? What is the timeline?
Oh, it's crazy. Because it used to be the only thing I did. It used to be there was never like original music coming out. There was never tours. There was never radio promo. There was never anything. So when it was originally like the only thing that I do, I would spend a whole week to kind of, and like each day throughout the week I would do something. So like one day I would work on the track, one day I would work on the vocals, one day I would work on the video, the next day I would edit it, and then that Friday I would post it.
Cool.
Now it is
quicker.
It is a six hour window of time that I like to like block off, and in that 6 hours I produce the track, I record the vocals, I shoot the video, and I edit it.
And it's
then
just
it
you.
Goes up. Yeah, just me.
Have you thought about adding somebody?
Yes. I feel like, you know, from the beginning, I always did things by myself. And I see one of the mistakes I see in social media is people, as they grow, they build the production value.
Yes.
And a lot of fans don't really care about production value. A lot of fans just want to see somebody in their room having fun. And so I still have as much fun as I used to have when I make videos. And so even though it's a lot harder, you know, I feel like it's something that I want to feel real and I want it to feel organic because that's all that it's ever been. So the more that I add people and it makes things easier for me, it also makes the fans will feel like, man, he doesn't care as much just because he's less busy.
Yeah.
He doesn't care as much about making this video the way that he used to do it. And so for fear of losing that feeling inside too, because I feel like if it's easier for me, then I'll probably not like it as much, you know?
And to your point, right, like you can even say that some of that there's proof, right, in the videos you posted. So your music video for, you know, Work the Middle.
Yeah.
Great video. You start the video with you in your room to catch people's attention because you know that's what they want to see, and then you change it.
Mm-hmm.
But then you go to the lyric video that you posted for the song, and it didn't do nearly as well as your other covers.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's because, you know, you weren't in your setting, you weren't in your room doing it.
And that's different. I mean, because that's original music. And so I think at some point you always want to grow and you always want to find the next thing.
Yeah.
But as I grow into original music, and yeah, my original music isn't going to be me in my bedroom because this is where I see myself as an artist. I see myself, you know, I want to put myself in the same place as the artists that are great now and the artists that have been great before, yeah. Like from Justin Bieber now to Michael Jackson before to, you know, to Sam Cooke and Stevie Wonder and all of those great artists who propelled themselves above everything and became, yeah. And became incredible artists that way. Just because I'm wanting to do that doesn't mean that my covers need to do that. I want to keep my covers a very vulnerable, open thing where I, you know, every time I start my videos, I do a big smile for the camera and like just the same things over and over again. Cause I feel like no matter how much I'm blessed for a career to have things grow and get bigger, yeah. I always want to stay that same kid that from Arizona who likes to make YouTube videos in his room, you know?
Which I think is incredible, right? Because you're in a position, right, in 2017, where you can also look back at musical history, so to speak, and see some of the YouTube cover artists that have either made it or not made it or made it real quick and yeah. Then kind of faded out.
It's crazy because you become... We're like you said, like there's a bunch of cover artists who have come before me, but at the same time, we're still kind of, it's still a new thing. Like,
yes.
That people look for covers. And so.
Oh, people love it. I watch them for hours.
It's awesome. I watch them for hours and hours. I have my friends and Will, who I'm on tour with right now, and Connor Maynard and
Dude,
Von
Connor
Terrell,
is amazing.
And they're all great. And so I'll watch their covers. And so we're definitely, while covers have always been around and other people have always reimagined people's songs, they're now so hot and yeah. accessible, and people are wanting to go find them sometimes even more. Like there's this John Mayer cover of EXO by Beyonce
yeah.
that I listen to more than I listen to EXO by Beyonce.
Totally.
And that's
it.
Beyonce, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So if people are looking for covers and they're trying to find them, and so since even though they've been around for a long time, we get to look back and we get to see artists who have done it very, very well, some artists who have done it not too well.
But you get to learn.
And we
right?
get to learn, but at the same time, we're also blazing the trail of an artist who is very like who is trying to keep I'm trying to keep that instead of abandoning it.
Yeah.
Abandoning it and also being an original artist. I still want to be posting YouTube videos even if I'm winning Grammys and
Hell
Grammys
yeah.
and post
mm-hmm.
And in platinum at records and everything. Covers to me are fun. That's why yeah. I like doing them. I don't do them to make money. I do them to have fun.
And you could say that some cover artists kind of like once they had a hit or two, they kind of left it behind, you know, it,
yeah.
it became second.
Or even before that.
Yeah, you're right. You know, one touch at radio,
yeah.
one sort of official kind of feeling or vibe, they pieced out of YouTube.
Because I feel like some people think that you have to be one or the other. Some
yeah.
people feel like, you know, there's big artists who can't be social media artists and can't do vlogs or can't do, you know, this. Or there's some, you know, social media artists who think that once you go to radio, you can't be a social media artist anymore.
Don't believe that.
That just means to me, that just means you're not work. You don't want to work.
Yeah.
You don't want to work as much.
Well, so you're 100% right.
I came to LA to work and to get work done, and I enjoy my work that I do.
Hell
and
yeah.
So I want to do as much of it as I can. So I think it'd be awesome if I could be on tour and then I fly home for one day to shoot a video in my parents' living room like I always have.
They
you know?
All funnel each other, right?
Exactly.
They all work together, kind of keeping the machine intact. And when one part goes out, like what?
I mean, look,
it doesn't work as well.
We're still yeah. here, and you're still, you know, you're in the position where you could have somebody else doing the show. You could just have Dan do the show,
yeah.
and you could be, you know, it could still be the Zach Sang show featuring, you know. But
I don't know. Would you want to come
thing.
In and just talk to Dan though?
I
feel like you like Dan.
Look, Dan, I got a lot of fun things to say.
I do not doubt that.
I feel like we got a real Dan fan here.
Yeah, I'm a Dan fan. I'm a Dan fan. Is your fandom
fan.
Called the Dan fans?
Yeah, there's a lot of them in there. Yeah, that's what they call themselves.
It's his mom and Zolot.
Uh-huh. And me.
And you,
great.
Alex. That's good.
Does it bother you, though, when people call you a YouTuber?
I don't. It's so funny because
be
I know a lot of people who, like, I'm not a YouTuber, I'm this. And it's just like, man, like, a duck is a duck, you know.
Yeah,
like
right?
you know, it's if it quacks like a duck and it looks
like
a duck.
Like a duck yeah.
If people want to call me a YouTuber, I don't mind. You can call me whatever you want. You could call me lame. You could call me bad, a terrible singer. You could call me fat. You could call me ugly. Mm. Whatever. I don't mind. I call myself Alex. That's my personal name.
And so, yeah.
If somebody is interested in me enough to take the time out of their lives to comment anything or to say anything, I feel like that's pretty cool,
right.
you know?
Yeah.
Even if it's hate, I feel like I've influenced somebody to do something. And if they have that hatred that they want to express, that's okay. Don't do it to my fans, do it to me, that's cool.
Were you nervous going from covers to originals, creatively and maybe for your audience?
Yes, but not because of the creative side. It's just that fans are so used to seeing me
doing covers. Yeah.
Do that. They're so used to listening to a song that they know already.
Exactly.
So that there's kind of like a base for them. I was super nervous, I'm not going to lie, to release an original song because people could be like, man, like, we don't like this. What is this? Who sings this original version? Yeah. And I'm like, it's me. And they're like, mm-hmm. we don't like it. But it's been awesome. The fans have been so incredible. And the music video did better in 1 week than any of my covers do. So
wow.
like usually the music video in or like, usually like my YouTube videos in 1 week will get 1 million views. And the music video in the first week did 4 million views.
Well,
so
all the comments
so
on
awesome.
The music video are, who's Jade? Every comment is Jade.
Shout outs to Jade Chenoth. So she was the main girl in that danced in the Work the Middle video. And she's the greatest dancer on earth. I think she's one of my very, very good friends. And she, when I first wanted to do the video, I was talking to Wildebeest who choreographed it. And I was like, yo, Jade's got to be the main girl in the video. She's such an incredible dancer.
Uh-huh.
And she's built her own fan base based off of, she's also an actress. She's on The Last Ship.
Cool.
On TNT. And she's also a very well-known dancer in the dance community. And so all of those like YouTube dance videos that other people put up, she's generally the main girl dancing in it. And
no
so
way.
I really wanted her to be in the video because I believed in her talent and I believe that she's an incredible dancer. And
it's keeping in the digital family and showing that like digital kids could really win. And
so
it's
people
a,
will
yeah.
come and they can, and it's great because people will come to my video, not even for me, for Jade.
For
you
her.
Know?
It funnels
and,
everything.
And it's and exactly, it all feeds everything. And that's why I feel like the people who are worried about, you know, like either, you know, giving the credit to somebody else or worried about not working on a specific thing because they don't want to be identified as something. To me, everything will feed everything. If you work hard on everything, everything will be fed. So if I'm working hard on my cover game, I'll build fans who will eventually love my original music. And if I'm building a bunch of original music, those fans will eventually love the creativity that I put into covers. And if I do a video with Jade or if I do a video with Will Sinj or I do a video with Connor Maynard, I'm not worried about people saying, man, Connor's better. I think Connor's incredible. I believe that Connor is an incredible artist. I believe Will is an incredible artist. I believe Jade is an incredible dancer. And I have the confidence in myself and the gifts that God gave me that I'm not worried about somebody else getting all the credit.
This is not about competition.
Exactly.
Because when I totally get that. I have my own group of friends where like when somebody wins, everybody wins.
Exactly. Because I want to see those people succeed because I think they are so great.
Yeah.
How was it filming that video though? Because you guys are pretty close. There was some like dry humping going on.
Dry humping.
There was at one point I was like,
let's just
talk about.
You know, I'll say it was a great day. It was a great day. No, they're all of the girls that were in the video are so great, and they're, you know, a lot of them are coming to my show tonight at the Novo and tomorrow night, and I just feel very, very blessed that I get to be around such incredibly talented people. And you know, music videos are always a little bit extreme and a little bit, you know, they want to go all out and we want to have fun and make it look great Jade and I have great chemistry together.
But do we walk away from that set thinking, hey, you know, maybe this could be more? You kind of tested it out, you know?
You know,
there's no, the awkward vibes are gone at this point.
Yeah, chemistry's chemistry. And so I think that, I mean, Jade is a very, very great friend of mine. And so
you tweeted the other day that you were looking for somebody to cuddle.
Yeah, I need cuddles constantly. Cuddles are.
Do you know there's services for that? I mean,
not
like massage places.
Okay.
Where they give you
whoa.
Things, but like there's like somebody will come and cuddle with you professionally.
Really? A professional cuddler?
Yeah, nothing sexual. Just the warmth of two human bodies.
Just a human body
next to each other.
We'll have to talk after the show so I can figure out this.
Yeah,
this, it's like a hotline or
I'll
something. It's an app.
I'll connect
Craigslist,
you with a guy.
Probably.
It's Craigslist. Yes.
Okay. How obsessed are you with YouTube analytics? Like, do you get caught up in it?
No.
You can be honest.
I mean, I like making sure that things, you know, if things don't look the same, if a video is not doing that well, I want to know why.
Yeah.
But you know, when I started making YouTube videos, I really did it for me. Like, all of my friends who were, when I started really doing like a weekly video, I learned from all of my friends who do YouTube videos on a weekly basis and have huge followings. And I did not have a huge following at the time. And the biggest piece of advice that they gave me is don't make videos for anybody except for you. If you make videos to try and make money, if you make videos to try and build a ton of fans, you're never going to get that. If you make videos to try and enjoy yourself and to push yourself creatively and to have fun, that's when naturally everything will grow. And so I look at analytics and I like make sure like, okay, cool. Everything's in line. That's cool. But the people who like watch every single number, you don't enjoy, one, you don't have fun because you get so stressed and frustrated. And two, you lose sight of the bigger picture, which is why you started doing something, which is to enjoy yourself, you know?
Spot on. I have a lot of friends who get lost in it real easy. Mm-hmm. And then, like, how do you create then? You know, if that's all you think about.
I got this phrase that I always call, it's called Lost in LA, because it's like these, like, people, like, these YouTubers will move out to LA and they get so focused on numbers and they go out and party and they do all this mm-hmm. stuff. And then, like, in a month, they're like, their numbers start dropping and they freak out. So then they party more and they try and like collab and then they become like all this like shadiness and like all that stuff. I call that Lost in LA. Like that's like the big Lost in LA party.
Phrase.
And so I like to not identify myself with any of that or
how
be a part of that.
Stay away from that.
So behind me, my sister is here.
I see her.
I stay very, very close. I keep myself very, very small. Like cool. I hang out with my family. I have a group of friends that I've had for a long time that are in the YouTube game. I have a lot of friends from back home. I have a lot of friends. I mean, and when I say a lot, I mean like about three or four in each territory. And then outside of that, I like to, I'm never negative. I'm never, you know, mean to anybody, but I like to keep my very close circle very, very small. And those are the people that I listen to. So if I'm having a bad day, if I get caught, if I catch myself reading comments that say, man, Alex, you suck, or Alex, like, go home, like, stop making videos. You're terrible. You're not that good. I always turn the screen off and I go to my family and I'm like, look, I just read a bunch of comments. I'm not having a great time. Let's go do something. And they know exactly what to do to keep me, you know, to keep me on the right path, on my mindset, keep me on the right path, like, you know, everything, physically, spiritually, all that.
When did you realize that you had to do this full time?
I'll fast forward or rewind, I guess, all the way back to when I was in eighth grade. And this was back in Arizona when I was growing up. And I grew up in a family that loved music. And when I was 14, I realized that this is something that I really, really wanted to do. Like this is what I wanted my life to be.
What happened? Why'd you realize? Like what clicked in you?
I just had been doing, you know, when you're a kid and you're growing up, you want to be this. And then like, you want to be this. Oh, my dad was a real estate agent. I wanted to sell homes for a bit. I saw my friend that was like playing basketball. So I was like, man, I want to be like the best basketball player. I want to go play in the NBA. Realize that's not possible.
I mean, you look like you can dunk. I don't know.
I'm trying to. That's my goal. That's like one of my 2017 goals is to dunk one time.
Slow and steady wins the race.
Yeah. But then like, I grew up in Arizona. I wanted to be a wakeboarder, but the only thing that was constant throughout was music. And I knew that, you know, being in the school choirs and doing talent shows and stuff, I knew that I loved doing it. And a lot of the people who were around me told me like, man, you like, God blessed you to do this. And so, I thought about it a lot and this is like right when YouTube was getting bigger and everything. And I was like, I want to move to LA and I want to work with, like, this is what I want my goal to be. And both of my parents are from LA. My dad's originally from New Zealand, but he moved out. Like he was raised in LA.
And you speak Spanish?
Not that well, but
broken Spanish.
Because I'm not Hispanic at all.
Oh, New Zealand and what?
My dad's half Samoan and half Maori, which is the native of New Zealand.
Cool.
So there's no Hispanic in my blood at all.
Do you have like a Spanish Wikipedia page, but you don't have an English Wikipedia page?
I was in Latin Esquire and I don't have, and wow. I'm not, you know,
I think
not Latin
people are
at
confused,
all,
so you know, just saying.
Which is cool. I mean, I grew up in Arizona. I grew up in Arizona and I live in Southern California, which are like two of the biggest, you know, like Hispanic areas in the whole United States. And so I was always like interested in the Spanish language. And so when One Dance came out and I wanted to try and like, I was like, man, this would be a great opportunity to try and learn Spanish really, really well. And so I'd started, you know, started working on it and I did the song. And then since then I've been trying to learn better, but I don't have anybody to talk to in Spanish. So if you're listening to this and you speak Spanish, just talk to me in Spanish.
I thought
learn.
You were going to say that last sentence in Spanish and I was going to be real impressed.
Yeah, if you're listening, no.
Have you always been a fan of dancehall? Because the new song, Work the Middle, kind of has a dance hall feel.
It's got the dance hall vibes to it.
And then the biggest YouTube video is the Drake one, which also has a dance hall feel to it.
So my dad's Polynesian Pacific Islander, and reggae music is a big thing. And dance hall is a version of that reggae island music that comes from the Caribbean and all that. So I've always been a big fan of it. But at the same time, you know, it's not like I was like, man, dance hall is what I want to do with my life. It just happened to be that Drake video did really, really well, and dance hall became a very popular and prominent sound in music now.
Yeah.
And so when we were working on a new song, we wanted the first single to have bits of the One Dance video so that if there were any fans who wanted to hear that One Dance vibe, they would get it. But also, we didn't want to be too close to One Dance so that everybody else would be like, oh, this is just a One Dance song, basically.
How do you go into that session? Did you have the song like formed in your head? Were you relying on the producers? What was it?
So we were actually, this was right when I started signing with Interscope, and we were writing, I was writing a bunch of songs. I was writing a bunch of songs by myself. I was co-writing a bunch of songs, and we were also taking songs in. And so One Dance, or Work the Middle is actually a song I didn't write on it at all.
Okay.
And so it was awesome because we had, we sat down and we had so many songs that I had written by myself, so many songs that we had co-written, and there were a lot of songs that we wanted to put out, but we felt like the first song needed to be a great bridge from the One Dance and the covers that I do, and the great, a great starting song to kind of show people, okay, I'm an original artist, this is what I want to do, and like this is the kind of music that I get, so that when we put out the next songs, if it doesn't sound just like the covers or it's a different area, they'll already have that preparation, like, okay, he's going to do something different.
Yeah.
And so a lot of the songs that I wrote, lot of the songs that I wrote or that I worked on didn't have that transition bit. They didn't have that good first single, this is what it's about to be. A lot of them were kind of over here.
Yeah,
because
I get that.
You know, because what I write is completely different than the covers that I make.
And you're crafting that. Like that's a muscle that you
build.
Yeah,
you're getting better
that.
At it. Yeah, getting better at it.
And you also acquire knowledge from the sessions you're in. Like, it just doesn't, you know what I mean? It doesn't just happen.
And I'm blessed to be working with a ton of incredible producers and songwriters who have written great songs before. And the writers and song and producers who did Work the Middle, they're all incredible. You know, they've written hits and they've done incredible things.
I looked at the list. I mean, people like Ty Dolla $ign and so many others that they've worked with.
So it was awesome to sit, you know, and again, without any ego, to sit backseat and be like, I didn't write this song, and I'm not trying to be, you know, I'm not trying to fake like I wrote a song, because I know what songs I write, and I'm proud of the songs that I write, and I love the songs that I write, and eventually those songs that I write will come out to everybody.
Yeah.
So I'm not in a rush to show that. I knew that Work the Middle was an incredible song, and to me, an incredible song is worth way more than I wrote this, you know?
Right. What does Work the Middle mean?
Ask your dad.
Are you kidding?
Is it like a sexual thing?
So Work the Middle can mean anything.
Oh,
Work the Middle. I feel like this is a conversation for after this interview. But,
no, it's going to happen right here because I need to know.
If you Urban Dictionary Work the Middle, it'll tell you something.
Can you really not figure this out?
No, I was listening to the song and
So if you were to think about like the middle region of your body.
And we have to like do to like you.
What?
It's about sit-ups.
Yes, it's about getting
ab workout. It's about doing crunches and
you remember
sit-ups.
What I said to him earlier today about earlier in the I said you and this person were doing this in the video.
Okay.
But the thing is
to have sexual intercourse.
So this is the thing. This is the thing though,
he
is
can't
that
work the middle like I can. That's
is that
an example.
Great. But the thing is that the song is so
it's fun.
Is so much more infectious in other ways.
It
like
is.
The beat and the drop that like I forget, you know, I'm on stage and I'm like singing it and everybody's singing it and kids are singing it and moms are singing it and everybody's like, Work the Middle. You forget, like, you know, it's just a great thing. And the intention of the song is not necessarily, you know, to that, like, it's about a girl. Like obviously it's about a relationship or it's about beginning of something and wanting to be with somebody, but like, it's not necessarily, I don't know, that's not who, like, I'm not a big, like...
I'm not a sexual demon, so...
I'm not a middle worker. I don't work middles often.
When the mood is right and when it's appropriate, you do.
Yeah, no, I'm a human being.
Yeah.
But, it's
just, I mean...
I think the song itself is bigger than the meaning of the term,
of course.
You know?
have you gotten, like, are you out of a relationship recently? Do you want one? Are you dating?
I am single. I am single as
on
a
purpose?
Pringle right now on purpose. And I do not intend on, I'm just so busy going on tour and everything. Like, if I had a girlfriend right now, it would not be well.
It's distracting.
You don't know them. Not even distracting. It's just I'm doing them a disservice. If I'm in a relationship, I want to love that person wholeheartedly. I want to give them as much time as I possibly can. And I don't even give myself any time right now. Like I'm working and I'm here and then I go straight to sound check and then I play a show and I do meet and greets and then I go to sleep. And then I wake up, I do the same thing over and over again. And so if I were to have a girlfriend that I guess have to put on the sideline just by default.
Yeah.
That's unfair to a girl. I want if I'm with somebody and I tell somebody I love them and I'm there for them, I want that to be the truth, you know?
Of course. And that's kind of like something that I've been playing with in my head as I try to go out and date, right? Mm-hmm. Because I've always used, and I don't want to call it an excuse. For me, it was an excuse. I'm so busy. And then I ask myself the question, how much time am I supposed to actually like dedicate to the person I'm in a relationship with? Like, do you need me for freaking 6 hours a day?
Well, some girls, you know? Some girls, like you know, I've been in relationships where the girl is like, they're the ones that's like, leave me alone, like I'm working, yeah. Or like, yo, like, why are you so clingy? Like sometimes I'm the clingy one, and sometimes the girl is the clingy one. And it just depends on what you want and what they want. And if what you want and what they want are not on the same path, then it's like hard. Like for me, yeah. Like if I'm with somebody and they want to FaceTime all the time or they want to be everywhere with me, I'm not at the place where I can do that. But if they're a girl who's at the same place where I'm, like they're busy and they're yeah. working, and if I don't talk to them that day, they don't get upset and all of that stuff. That's like, that's just where I am. It's not where I want to be for the rest of my life. But like at the current moment, if I was in a relationship, if a girl wanted more than that, I would feel terrible because I want to give them as much as they want. I want them to be as happy as they should be, but I can't.
Are
if
you
they want that, you know?
Comfortable hooking up on the road, or do we like eliminate that as a whole?
I mean, my sister's on the road with me, so that's kind of like a great way to
to
keep
prevent
yourself
it?
From. I just, you know, I'm a meaningful type person. Like I want things to have meaning. I'm not very much so like a, hey, tonight's cool and you are very attractive. Let's do something.
Dude, that's you're talking to a 23-year-old virgin.
I totally
get it. You're not a virgin, are you?
I
21?
I don't want to talk about this right now. My sister's in the room.
Oh my gosh.
I'll tell you something. I do not sleep with people.
Okay. Okay. Now we know. That's okay. Seriously.
I have rings on that remind me to do good things.
That's beautiful. I mean, religion plays a big role
in your life. I'm a very, very spiritual person, very religious.
Yeah. I mean, God, right? Catholic? What is it? Christian?
I'm Mormon, actually.
Mormon?
Yeah.
Wow.
Do you like the Book of Mormon?
Yes, I love the Book of Mormon. It's great.
I couldn't get tickets. I wish I could. I wanted to
Oh,
see
you're
it.
Talking about the play. I thought you were talking about the actual book.
The real Book of Mormon. Dan doesn't know what the real Book of Mormon is.
I think it's
is.
Great. I think the Book of Mormon is an incredible musical play. I've seen it one time and it was like it's totally I think it's hilarious.
Beautiful. Yeah.
But I'm also very good at knowing what's a joke and what's an attack, you know.
Yeah.
So
I mean, this is like an interesting world for you to be in as like as
oh,
a Mormon.
Yeah.
I mean, like you have, I mean, the music industry, the YouTube social space. I mean, you're surrounded by self-indulgence, sexual demons, money
yeah.
spending, crazy people.
As I walk
people.
Through the shadow of the valley of death, I take a... Yeah, it's like, I feel like that's literally me. I feel like I'm Coolio sometimes.
That's what I think when I look at you, Coolio.
Yeah.
It's the first thing that comes to mind. I mean, so you keep your sister, you keep God in your life. That's how you keep straight. Where are your parents right now?
They've been the best, like my sisters included, have been the greatest family when it comes to supporting a dream, because all of us, like when we moved out of Arizona, there were a ton of people who were like, you're moving to LA? Like, this is crazy. Like, he's gonna, like, before the success happened, they were like, he's not gonna have success. Like, that, you know how, like, crazy that is? And then when I had success, it was always, well, now he's gonna do drugs, now he's gonna do this. And so my family has been such solid rocks. Like, they have been so incredible in supporting me and trusting me to make the right decisions, and my parents trusting that they raised us a certain way so that we will make, you know, right decisions, and we won't go and be doing cocaine in the bathroom or sleeping with girls every single night. Like, that's not, you know, that's not what I do. And it was a big part of that is based off of my parents.
That's awesome. Have you walked away from those situations before while living in LA?
Oh my God.
All the time.
It's so hard.
Is it?
It's the hardest thing. Because.
Is it hard because you want to do it?
No, it's hard because it's just, it's so out here. It is so in your face. It is literally like, bang, like you come to a party and you grab a drink and you do drugs and you do that. I stopped going to parties, you know? I stopped, like, I don't do, like, if people knew, like, what I actually do, I go home, I'll hang out with my sisters, and if they're all busy, I will literally just go to sleep. Like, I work on a YouTube video and then I'll go to sleep. And so it's, you know, there's the bright lights and there's the flashy things and you see the parties and oh my gosh, this person showed up to a party and he played a full set and he did this, and then we all took a limo to the Hollywood sign and sat in a hot tub and talked and we had a great night and the sun came up and it was cool. But then it's also like, you know, there's also positives to being able to say like, yeah, no, I don't do that stuff. And,
exactly.
And it separates yourself.
And
you know?
Also become numb to it at a certain point, right?
At some point you're just like, oh yeah, no, that's not cool to me. That's not my thing, you know?
That's it. I like sleeping.
I thoroughly enjoy sleeping.
So what'd you do on your 21st birthday? You just turned 21, right?
Yeah. My sisters, it was about a month ago. We played a show that night. And we literally played a show, and I think did we go to Applebee's? Oh, we did go to Applebee's.
Yeah.
Went to Applebee's. Right. I had half prize appetizers.
Yes. Yes.
Shout outs to half prize apps. And I got a blondie. Have you ever had the blondie from Applebee's? The greatest thing on earth.
What am I? Inexperienced?
When you pour the sauce on it and it's like,
oh, stop.
Oh, yeah.
So we did that, and then we went to sleep. Like, that's, to me, that's enjoyable.
You didn't even have a drink?
No, I don't drink.
At all?
No, I don't drink. I don't do any drugs. I don't drink.
Have you ever smoked weed?
I don't. I've had moments in my life where I've wanted to try things, but I've,
okay.
I at this current point in time, I've for a long time now, I've been very,
wow.
I abstain.
Dude, that's impressive.
Thank you very much.
Very impressive. Going to Half Price Apps, grabbing a blondie.
You know, I actually, you know what I did? I got a free beer and I gave it to my tour manager.
That was nice.
Well, because I don't drink, you know, it's just not my thing, you know? So, but they were like, it's a free beer. And I was like, no, at first. Then he's like, hey, can I have your free beer? And I was like, wait, come back. It was my birthday, so I guess I'll have my free beer. I got it.
When do we have the album coming?
Man, we've been working on a lot of new music recently, and whether it's an album or it's an EP, whether it's a couple of singles,
okay,
we don't know yet. We are wanting to see how Work the Middle does, see what the fans think of it. If they love that sound, we'll put out more music like that sound.
Great.
If they're like, this sounds cool, but we want to hear more this, then, you know, then we can
gotta
do more
of that.
Yeah.
You know how to read your audience, and you know how to read, like, you know, you know how to do what they want you to do, and they respond and they're active.
That's the best thing about my fandom, is that they literally are honest with me. And like, sometimes honesty hurts. Like, sometimes they're all like, man, we don't really love that, but we do love you and we want you to do more great things.
You need
that. And so that's awesome, because I can say to myself, like, okay, you know, say, fortunately, Work the Middle has had such great, like, love, and everybody's been awesome and positive about it. But if they had been like, man, Work the Middle's cool and we're so happy that you're doing original music, but this isn't really our sound, then I would get to be like, okay, great. I have a ton of other sounds that we want to try. And the best thing is that my fans are so patient with me. They've been on this journey with me and they've been so incredible that I get to take this time with them and be like, do you like this? Okay, do you like this? Do you like this? And then once we find that, we can go out and we can go to radio with it, and we can, you know, and we can spend all of the money that people spend for promotion and to get the song in, like, in big, you know, opportunities.
Does the enormity of the music industry scare you a little bit? Because there's a lot of big budgets attached to things.
Yeah.
There's a lot of, I mean, dude, Interscope's a really big label.
Yeah.
You know, Universal is huge. There's a lot there, man. It's you're in a bigger playing field.
The competition's
different.
That's exactly the thing, is that it's, Interscope is such a big, you know, we jumped from the small pond that is YouTube when it comes to the music industry, which is still a massive pond. And we went to we're testing the water here in like you say, the traditional music industry, where we have the biggest of big fish. I'm in the same waters right now, putting myself in the same situations, trying to get the same radio play as Taylor Swift and as Justin Bieber and Ed Sheeran and Rihanna and Justin Timberlake. All of those people, I am now, I like to think I am now like running in an Olympic race, and those people are there.
Beautifully said.
And those are artists that I look up to. So it's a great moment to say to myself, I get to look back and I can be like, wow, I'm playing on the same radio station that I listened to when I was a kid, which is crazy.
That's awesome.
But then at the same time, the enormity, like you say, of these big budgets, and you have, you know, being completely transparent, you have, like, you know, recoup. Like, you know, you have to pay people back, and you have to do this, and you have to have that. All of that pressure is, I feel, it comes natural with coming into this big pond. Mm-hmm. This is the fee you have to pay to get into the amusement park so that you can go on all the rides. And having the faith in myself and having it, like, coming back to kind of everything that we've been talking about, having that small circle, having the family that we keep those values very, very tight, and having a team that respects the values that I have and respects the speed that I want to go at, that the turtle wins the race, and not really trying to rush anything or do anything crazy, and not trying to get popular, you know, off of controversy or anything, and just trying to be myself and do that and just do what I love and continue pushing myself to work harder and harder, I think is going to help kind of curb that the stress and the pressure of making sure I can recoup money and making sure I can do that. Because if we have fun and we push ourselves and we work hard, and I work harder than anybody else that I know,
good things will follow.
I believe that the good things will follow from God, you know?
Alex Iono, thank you for hanging out.
Thank you for having me.
The single is called Work the Middle.
Yeah, yeah.
Check it out. I learned what it meant today.
Learn what it means.
Nobody really told me, but Urban Dictionary did.
Urban Dictionary is your new dad.
That's it. my new dad.
Yeah.
Anything else on your mind?
Well, of course. Well, I'll just ask easy ones. Like
ask me anything.
No, just easy one-word answers. I just have a few things written down.
Great.
What's better, touring money or YouTube money?
Like more?
What's better?
In the long run, touring money.
Okay.
But immediacy right now, it's probably
Well, right
YouTube.
Now, YouTube is my biggest thing. Like YouTube is like the biggest thing that I... That
you do
I,
well?
I like to have fun, and I feel very blessed that I'm in a place where I can live off of the money that I make.
Draw my life. Did you draw those things yourself?
No. Oh my gosh, people comment that all the time, and it's the funniest thing. Like if I drew my life, you wouldn't know what my life was. You'd be like, I think that's Flubber from the 1990s movie Flubber.
Great movie.
And is there any instrument that you've wanted to learn you just can't get the hang of?
Didgeridoo.
What the hell is that?
I never tried it. It's that big, like, pipe thing, and you go...
Like they use in Africa?
Yeah. Well, they use Australia. Isn't it Australia?
Maybe both.
It sounds
I don't
Australian.
Know.
Didgeridoo sounds
Oh, wait. Like, is it a horn? Like, it's like...
It's like a horn, but it's also, like, it's kind of just, like...
Is it like the size of your body? Yes.
Is that the thing they do at soccer games?
No, that's
a vuvuzela.
Like, yeah, that's... Right, I hate those things.
Yeah, those are dumb. That's a
like kazoo. It's like a glorified kazoo.
Alex Iono, thanks for hanging out, man.
Hey, thanks. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for taking the time.
All right.
Yeah. Woo. Yeah. Alex Iono, everybody. Okay.